Yeah, so I believe like we had an introductory, we had a basic introduction to LSTM like last week for people who have like very little idea about LSTM. So this week we are like diving more into like our specific use case like for language modeling and like other NLP tasks. So here like the basic idea for like today that I want to discuss are like some common like it's the papers I have here like open are like regularization and optimization for LSTM for language models and like yeah this is just to introduce a concept of dropout in case you don't know what like in case we need to explain dropouts. Here basically like when we say like let me think someone is trying to join. Just like I'll share my screen. So, like Joel last time explained basically the idea of what do you say, like the idea of LSTM, like you have four gates. Like you have four gates and like the input gate, like the memory gate, the forget gate and output gate and things like that. And he explained how like you use sigmoid and like tanh functions to kind of create these memory cells which can like store information. Now I want you guys to look at this from another perspective. Like I don't have to share screen right now. So the other perspective I'm kind of mentioning here is like from the probability point of view. Like okay, so here the thing is like we are trying to build like we're trying to predict what word comes like what sequence of words comes after like we're trying to form sentences. So like are you guys like familiar with like Bayes' law and things like that? Like you guys know what Bayes' law is, right? Hello. Guys, like, can you hear me? Yeah, so here we have to like from the probability standpoint of view, we have to calculate like the probability that a word is likely to occur given all the previous occurrences of word in the sentence. So that is what we're trying to model. We're trying to optimize like we are trying to because end of the day you are trying to like you can't predict something like even if it's a neural net program you are not like determining which image it is we are like which like this if an image is a cat or a dog or like if this is an accurate sentence or not you are determining like this is probably a like the sentence and this is probably a cat these are I this like that is like how all these functions work. So that is what you're trying to optimize. You're trying to like increase the probability that you like earn confidence in your predictions. So when you're like doing neural nets. So here like when you consider that from probability stand of view, you have like I'll share my screen. So if you have a sentence like and like he was here he was young and let's say he was raised here. So here, like in these two sentences, you have a, like the probability that, like, you know, was appears after he is like pretty high, and like so you have those kind of relationships. Like so thing is, like, that is what you're trying to, so like young, when you consider the word young, it's highly that it comes like, you know, the probability that he was occurred, and like you have young, so that is like very probable situation. That is what you're trying to optimize. So this has nothing to do with like the topics I'm discussing right now, but I just thought it would be nice if you like also thought from a probability standpoint of view. So let's get to our regular paper, like normal paper. So this is a paper like regularizing and optimizing LSTM language models. Have like anyone here use like FastAI library or something?
Yes.
Who was that? Like.
Praveen. This is Praveen.
Yeah. So like if you have you tried like, you know, language modeling and like similar tasks in like FastAI.
Yeah.
So you know that AWD LSTM, right?
Yes.
So this paper is a foundation for that like AWD LSTM model.
Right. By Salesforce, right?
Yeah, this is by Salesforce. So basically we are like, this introduces two concepts, like obviously it's regularizing and optimizing. So like here they have like talked about like different, it's basically concept of dropout and like weight drop LSTM and like optimization using like SGD and different implement, like, and they have something called average SGD, which is like, and other like things which would be possible and things like that. So that is what they're trying to explain here. So I'm getting way ahead of myself. So let's talk about this thing. Let's talk about the concept of dropout. We'll focus on like regularization. So, okay, why do we need regularization? So I assume like most of you know what like overfitting is. So like, you know, you have, so when you have like that, when you're like training like any sort of training algorithm, any sort of like machine learning algorithm, let it be regression or like I don't think it happens in regression, but like classification or like, you know, clustering and things like that, even if it's supervised or like reinforcement learning, you have a high chance that you're going to either underfit or like overfit. So like, so you guys, what's your listing on like an overfitting and this thing? Like anybody? So basically you have like data, and you're training data, and you're like adjusting weights and things like that on the neural net. And like, let's talk about reinforcement learning. And thing is like, you have this problem where like your data is like so good at identifying your like training set, but so your training loss is pretty low. Like you have very low training loss and like you have very high validation loss, because like the weights just adjusted to like identify the specific data. So that is kind of a big problem. Like that happens from time to time. So how you go around it is like, either you can increase the amount of data you have, and that is like not that good an option, because like that, like for most data sets that isn't really an option. So what we can do is like, we have all this regularization techniques. So what it does, like it prevents it from converging too much. Am I making sense so far? Hello.
Yeah, listening, it's making sense.
So like you have like many this thing, you have like, so for like you know how like neural net, you have this function, you have this like, you know, this thing, like we have all these inputs which are like firing to an like activation function, and you're getting input. Like, so what here it happens is like, if you're finding a linear combination of this thing, so each one has a weight, so and like you're multiplying the input with the weight, and you're adding a bias, and you're passing that through an like activation function, and you're getting an output. So but for this, like, and you're like, you're finding the error, and you're like using that error to update the weights. So this is like the basic principle of reinforcement learning. But here, so here we can anyway change the output. So what we're doing is like, we are like, so in case of like, you have normal regularization techniques like L1 and L2 and all, I'll just brush past what you're doing there, in which case what you're doing is like, you're adding another factor like to this entire, like, you know, WX1 plus B plus WX2 like WX1 plus WX2, W1X1 plus W2X2 and things like that equation, that neural net equation, you're adding an external term. So that is like what L1 and L2 this thing happens. So like, and it depends on this parameter, like lambda by 2m, they have this, and multiplied by something like, which is purely dependent on the weight. So this, and when you calculate error on that, because like you're taking derivative of that, and you're passing that, and you're using that to update this, update the weights. So when you're adding another value to this like updation process, what happens is like, you're kind of preventing it from like converging to a like local, to a point where like it's sat, converging to a point where like, if you're not following, tell me, okay? So yeah, so that have like, but that is not what we are like interested in right now. So that's what I'll just brush past. So you have all like, you're basically, you have this thing of like, when you're passing this parameter here, like I'll explain that, you're, and you're like doing and you're like updating weights based on that. So you like, you have algorithms like as like stochastic gradient descent and all for updating weights in like normal neural network, because you can like, okay, let's go back a few steps. So you have like neural nets, with each node having its corresponding weights, and like, so you can't just randomly keep on like, you know, changing weights and like seeing if it can, if it has lesser loss. So what you actually do around, so what you do is like, you're trying to minimize the error. So how do you find the error? Like, you know what the output is, you know the output is y, that is what you're supposed to get. And let's say like y dash is the output you get. And thing is like, difference between this, okay, the like distance between these two points, like that is the error. And you're like, let's say that is dw, like in, or dy, because it's delta or delta y. And you're using that delta y to update all these weights. So that is how error correction happens. So like, instead of when you're doing like L1 or L2 normalization, like that is kind of normal, like this thing which you're going to use in normal like classification problems, like not in case of neural nets and all. So you're adding another parameter to this, so that like it's not strictly dependent on the weights. It's okay, right? But here, like the concept of dropout is, so here you have this entire process where you're like adding another value, you're calculating another value, and things like that. Or what you can do is like, so now, okay, you have a complex neural net. So let's say you have a complex neural net. Okay, you have this complex neural net. Okay, now you have like, hey. Okay, now you have this lines, you are like, this goes like this. And like, let's say, and you have this like multiple layers, you have like, you know, all those hidden, and I'll show it here, probably have an image. Okay, let's say like, okay, let's take this image for now. So what happens here is like, see, you have all this, can you see this image? Wait, what is that image? Okay, let's see, let's take this image for example. So what here is like, you have this fully connected neural net. Fully connected is like every input goes into like every other output. So you have this complex, so you have to prevent this from overfitting. So what happens is like, so you know, you're applying that, what you're doing is like, you're randomly selecting like some connections. You're randomly ignoring some connections. Like, let's say here, like you have connections to this being ignored. You have connections to these being ignored, connections to these being ignored. And like that, so you like, you know, skip some layers, so skip some nodes, skip some weights, depending on the type of dropout, which I'll get back to in more, like get back to more in later. So what happens is like, now you have like random inputs being, so it like learns itself to depend on like lesser factors. So what happens is like, it kind of prevents like, you know, overfitting and things like that, without like, you know, without more computation. Am I make like, is it understandable like so far? Alan?
Yeah.
Nitin, like Praveen, script itself cool, right?
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, so like here what they're doing is like, so now you have this, you have this RNN. Okay, you have this like RNN where like, it's all mathematical. So like, we have this, like if you're using pre-trained models, like, and faster, and if you're like implementing this in PyTorch, like for each layer, like you have an input layer and like multiple hidden layers and an output layer. So for like each layer, what happens is like you have this probability that this thing is being, you have like this keeps probability, or like the probability that you are going to keep, you know, keep the inputs to a weight, inputs to a node. So what happens is like, if say you have four nodes and you have a keep probability of 3, so what happens, like there is like, you're going like, the probability that, you know, one of the nodes gets its activation, or like is going to pass its, like going to send its output to the next stage, is like 1/4, because you have four nodes, and it's like, because it has 0.75 probability that it's going to be kept. Like if it's a key probability of 0.75, then it has like a 3/4 chance that it's like, that is how it happens in PyTorch, and I think TensorFlow, I'm not sure. But you have that, this thing in FastA, if you're using the FastA library. And I'm more familiar with FastA, that's why I'm like making FastA references. FastA in PyTorch. So yeah, getting back to this, what here they're doing is like, so for LSTMs, you have like two kind of this thing. So remember when I said you're calculating probability that, it's probably here. Remember when I said, like, you know, you're going to, like, you know, find probability that a word is going to occur given, like, other words occur, like, given other words have occurred, like, you have those, like, those kind of this thing, you have those kind of, so you have, like, here you have something called, like, word embedding dropout, and, like, for our case, we have something called weighted, like, our paper uses, we skip nodes, like, this thing, but, like, yeah, they have mentioned word embedding dropout. So, like, what word embedding dropout happens, it's like, anybody remembers, like, what word embeddings are? Okay, so word embeddings are like a sort of mathematical representation of this words, like, mathematical representation of words, like, so, like, similar words appear together. So if you're, like, trying to visualize, like, a word embedding, you get, like, similar words or words that occur together are, like, grouped similarly. So you have a vector corresponding to, like, you have a vector or, like, group of numerical value, like, or coordinates, whatever you want to call it, associated with this, like, words. So what you're doing is, like, you're going to drop that out at random. So if you're using a word embedding, like, for your LSTM, which is a high chance you're probably going to in most cases, in, like, normal cases. So things like identical to dropping words at random throughout the input sentences. So what happens is, like, basically you're trying to, like, you have this memory, you have, like, we discuss how LSTM depends on, like, previous inputs and things like that. So what you're doing is, like, you're kind of, ignoring, like, some words in between just to have a more, like, or, like, the syntax of it just to have, like, just to prevent it from overfitting, just to cause a sense of randomness to the data. But, like, you know, you can't do that on a, like, high this thing for LSTMs, because if you drop words in between, like, it would probably lose its sentiments and, like, its semantics totally. So here what we are doing is, like, for the entire neural network architecture, we are using dropout. And see, the way dropped LSTM applies recurrent regularizing to a drop connect mask on a hidden to hidden concurrent weights. So, like, I've talked this on, like, the previous video or something, like, so we have LSTMs, we have, like, what do these, like, you know, each layers actually represent, like, for an image it's like all this small patterns, for languages it's more like layers of complexity in, like, language formation, like, as each layer so what you can do that on input layers and we can do that on output layers, so we are, like, dropping weights on, like, you know, hidden layers. So we are, like, dropping from hidden to hidden layers, like, connections between, like, the hidden layers, that's where we're gonna apply dropout. And they called it, like, drop connect mask. So basically you're multiplying it with a probability mask that it's going to be chosen or not, and you're gonna apply the threshold. That's what, like, drop connect mask is. That's how, like, the entire dropout this thing is, like, using masks. So yeah, you have, like, other strategies for, like, you know, regularization as back propagation through time, where you're, like, sending your inputs back in time, like, to verify. You're comparing multiple lines together and things like that in this case. And you have, like, activation regularization, where you're, like, and things like that. These are all. So, like, Is that part clear? Like, I don't think it's clear. I don't think I did a good job, but like, yeah. Do it, like, is it clear, like, that part? Do you understand, like, what dropout is? Okay, so that is basically what, like, AWD LSTM does for, like, regularization. You have, like, other regularization methods, but, like, that is something you do. And you have, like, I'm not getting the max part of it right now. And you have, like, optimization. You have, like, when it... So what, like, normally how do you do it? Normally you do is using stochastic gradient descent. Where, like, okay, so what happens during stochastic gradient descent is, like, pretty simple. You're like, you haven't, you're trying to find a minima, like, you're trying to minimize the error, right? So, like, you're, let's say, before we get to, like, SGD, I just remembered something. So we have this, like, task. So why we need regularization? So here you have, like, this paper, which is, like, applying dropout, which is the application of dropout in RNNs, which is something I found. I'll discuss more on that. So here you have, like, this thing. You have, like, you know, you have non-regularized, like, LSTMs, which have, and you have that with, like, embedding dropout. And what happens is, like, you can see the significant, like, loss, like, you have, like, 127.4 as a loss in, like, as test loss, while here you have, like, just 86. Like, you can see the difference in, like, this thing with and without dropout, because, yeah, and thing, and, like, so this kind of increases this thing and, like, also kind of avoids overfitting of data, like, because it's not too see that, like, it's not too much distributed. And you have, like, stochastic gradient descent, where what you're doing is, like, okay, you have, like, your new weight is your old weight minus a learning rate into, like, delta of loss function of the old weights. Like, what happens here is you have, like, let's say you have an error function which is a parameter. What is this column? Okay, so you have this as your error function. And now let's think about something else for a minute. So you have this as your, like, in this, okay, that looks wrong. You have this as your, like, let's say you have this as your curve for your function, for your loss function. Like, this is you plotting your error. You're trying to minimize error. So let's say, like, the error is minimum at this point, like this point. And now we have a ball here. Okay, so if you're just letting it slide, so what you're doing is, like, you're multiplying, you have your final output, you're subtracting that, you're, like, so what you, the, how do you call the error? Like, error is, like, your intended output minus your, the output you got. So that is, let's call that delta y, or, like, dy, assuming it's small. So now what happens is, like, you have dy, and you're, so now we are like, you can just pass it through dy because dy might be small and you don't want it to converge on this. So what you're doing is like, you're multiplying it with a this thing lambda. So your new weight is like w minus w dash minus alpha dy, if that makes sense. So what happens is like, yeah, so if you're, it's like inversely, so the point at which this reduces like directly proportional to dy. So yeah, I think like most of you already here know what stochastic gradient descent is. We're trying to minimize that. So, and alpha is called a learning parameter. And okay, so what here the paper does is like, it, we have like multiple optimization algorithms. Like you have like this thing called ADAM, you have like RMS prop where like the loss function is basically root mean square and this thing. And you have like, you can also like change momentum, like you can add the concept of momentum, and you have a momentum stochastic gradient descent. So you have all this, but here what they've gone with, and they, according to them, yields the best result is like the concept of this thing, averaged stochastic gradient descent. So here what they're doing is like, instead of taking just the last output, they're taking an average of all the weights, like take identical to, but returns the last iterator solution. Like here what you're doing is like, you're like taking the average of all previous calculated weights, and that is your new weight, like along with the new like you're doing SGD as usual, but here what you're doing is like, you're finding the average of all weights, and that is what you're returning. So yeah, now like anything, like, you know, if anybody like correct me, or like if I like correct anything like that, or like anything to add on or something, or like anything you didn't understand.
The averaging part, like at what points do we take the like weights?
No, like this is the averaging part I'm talking about, like, you know, stochastic gradient descent.
Right.
So when you're like optimizing that, just, what you're doing is like, what do? You get the like new outdated weight from this SGD, right? So instead of that, what you're doing is like, you have all this previous like weights you've calculated over previous iterations.
Right. So we just store that away and finally take all the average of that.
No, you calculated your new this thing, you're gonna append that.
Huh.
And you're going to take average of all of that.
Okay.
Anything else? Like, see, can you see, Praveen?
Huh.
Yeah, so like, see, they're appending it, and then what they're doing is like, they're taking the return is like average over all iterations.
Uh-huh.
Like while stopping right here, not meant, they're like appending all the weights, and right, they're taking the average for this. You can see the algorithm here.
Right. And at the end, the final trained model is the averaged one.
Yeah. Like the way the, like after the stochastic descent, like that's what the output is. And then you're training the weight new with new weights. You're getting the new error. You're doing that. So yeah. Anything else? Like that was pretty quick actually. So yeah.
I think a couple of things on the regularization side also that was I thought was important was one is they are doing a recurrent dropout, so that thing is happening, and they have two other strategies also, right? The activation regularization and
they have like this paper temporal. I'll tell you what this paper actually does. This paper is a comparison. So what here they like, here they have like, they've gone, they've like, I'll show you the, like, if you look at the references, 3 pages of references, they have like compared all this, like all these papers, and they are like computing the, like, you know, there we have AWD LSTM, and like you are doing all this variable listing, and you are like, okay, this has the least error.
Right. They want to find the best possible ways of regularizing and doing things.
So that is the, like, outcome of this paper. You have weight dropping. You are just weight dropping. You have like full size embeddings. You are like having an embedding matrix along with it, and you have like, you know, this entire AR and TAR, this thing. What was that again? Like activation regularization. So you have all this, like, all these models, and you're like, they're doing all this validation and this thing, and like how many parameters with similar number of parameters. I don't want to get into that much detail because last time I went, it's like, it was like all over the place. So it's like, no, the entire, that is, so like, should I also like try to cover, should we also like try to discuss that?
I mean, depends.
We have time.
If others are also interested.
Guys. Okay. Alan, Srividya. Guys. We have time. Let's like, you guys have the paper?
Yeah.
For those who don't have the paper, I'll put it here. And we'll like this way, now that, like, you know, most people have a regular idea, we'll just discuss it as we go. Like, I think that would be better. Right?
Huh.
We have like, you know what regular, if you know like regularization and optimization is like, then we can just skim through this, like, or like go through this. You have like, naively applying. Other firm act upon, like, you have batch, I think they have like recurrent batch normalization and all that. I mean, discuss here. What is that we should do, like, guys? What do you like? How do you want to proceed?
I think the main 3 points were, first was the dropout itself, and the activation regularization, and weight tying or something. So, how I approached this was, I was just searching on different resources regarding this, and there's very few available.
There's this thing called like connected graph, connected papers. Do you know about it? Have you heard of connected papers?
Yes. It shows you all the relevant papers in a graph format, right?
Exactly. So that is what I did. That's what I do now, like when I'm reading a paper.
That's a good way to go about things. Otherwise, it's impossible to find out.
Especially the, like, newer papers.
So I found this, they have this book also, right? Fast AI people. So in that, they have done a small explanation sort of thing. I'll just maybe share my screen and show that. I think they have done a good job of summarizing that key points. Is it possible for me to share the screen? It's
I think so. Coming. It's on the like left hand corner.
I'm clicking it, but I think it's not activated or something.
One second. I think I can. You can like share your screen.
No, it's not. I mean, I'm clicking it, but nothing is happening.
Okay, like notification. You have no notification things like that.
Oh, okay.
Like you have to allow it, right?
It says, I mean, I had blocked it earlier, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't know where the strange चलो हटा दिया. Now select window or screen. Allow. Okay, can you see the screen?
Yeah.
हाँ. So they have mentioned the same thing like you had told about dropout. So the same thing of how like in a normal neural network you have all the connections and after applying dropout you randomly leave out some of these connections and it forces the network to like not depend on particular neurons and like generalize it.
Basic concepts like this, I think, like deep learning, like, you know, you have those YouTube clips, like deeplearning.ai that puts up that.
Yeah.
It's like the good job of explaining basic stuff.
Exactly. So, so that is one thing. And I mean, dropout is the regular dropout thing itself. Then this activation regularization, like you mentioned in the beginning regarding L1 and L2 regularization, like where we add in your L1 loss or L1 term or the L2 term with the loss. Instead of that, they are adding the mean of the activations. So they're taking the squared activation and taking the mean of that and along with a hyperparameter alpha. So this forces the activations to be of smaller values. So one is this, and the second one is this thing. This is quite important, I guess, because if you imagine generally about LSTMs and RNNs, you want the, I mean, there needs to be a like time-based relationship in your data to model, I mean, your data using LSTMs and RNNs, right? That's why we are using it in the first place, because there is a sequential structure in the data. Now,
that is something like the other paper on like dropout this thing. That's something they've mentioned. Like, you know, you can like dropout is much easier to the concept of dropout is much easier to implement on like and like for basic regularization. It's like easier to implement on things like CNNs and like things like that. But for RNN, it's like dependent on past output. So it's like so you have to be careful how you regularize it.
Yeah. If we delete terms in between, then if that is dependent on the previous ones and the next one depends on that, when you have deleted that, then how does that work?
Exactly.
And all that.
So that's
why it
problem.
Becomes tricky.
Yeah.
So this this activation, temporal activation regularization is basically you are forcing the consecutive activations to be of a similar range. So you don't want like consecutive activations across the time dimension. You want it to be of a similar, what do you say? I mean, you want the difference to be near to zero. You want the difference of the nearby terms to be close to zero, because difference between two consecutive activations should be as small as possible.
Small as possible, yeah.
So that they do it by like subtracting one after the other activations with each other and taking the mean and adding that to the loss also. So this also forces the activations to behave in a like proper way, so that there's not a large difference between one time step to the next time step activation.
Yeah, and also like, you know, there's a thing like for activation, I don't know how much this applies here, but like for functions, because like such as Stanich and all, like the thing is like if like the input is kind of, you know, fixed in a small region, what happens is like it becomes linear, like you don't have like the entire range of the function is not being utilized. So when like that situation occurs, like for Tanach and like sigmoid and all, it becomes like pretty linear at times.
Right then there's
so
no point in
kind of,
the knowledge.
Yeah, exactly. So like, and because like, you know, LSTM and all like has a lot of dependencies on that, I think.
Yeah.
And again, with activations and things like that.
Yeah. And then finally, they talk about this weight tie. And I think this is also a common trick that they, I mean, everyone uses, because you have your input embedding layer, and ideally you want the output weights to be same as the input weights, because like they are representing basically like same words are being represented, so you don't want two separate matrices for that. Instead of that, the same
thought of that.
it has to do the same thing. So yeah, I guess these three are the main things that they've highlighted in this book.
And like I believe like this, like both FASE and like this thing, like they've trained it on like PenBang and like Wikitext, right?
It's
like, so yeah, that is kind of it, right?
Nidin
or Alan, like you guys want to add something, like have something, anything, or like what should we like wind up, or like should we discuss something else? So anyway, I was thinking, like, you know, with Pep, I'm gonna end this live stream now. One second.